Hey everyone, welcome back. We are diving deep today into 40 years of change on Mitcham Common, and our artifact for this trip down memory lane is a special anniversary issue of the Magpie newsletter. You know, that publication that's been like the voice of the Friends of Mitcham Common for I don't know how many decades now.
It really is amazing how this newsletter has acted as kind of a time capsule all these years. You can really see the community's love for this place and their concerns reflected in its pages.
Yeah, and get this issue is like a total blast from the past. They've recreated the style of their 1984 edition for the anniversary.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so we get to see what's changed, what's stayed the same. Maybe even some weird parallels to our own lives. Should we just jump right in?
Let's do it.
The first thing that really jumped out at me was this piece by Rose Chandler about litter. It's kind of funny how some things never change, right? Even back in 84, they were dealing with like the aftermath of picnics gone wrong, just like we are today.
It really is a timeless struggle, isn't it? But you know what I find really inspiring is the dedication of these volunteer groups like the Valiant Litter Pickers, the VLPs.
The VLPs love it.
They've been at it for years and years, just diligently clearing up other people's trash. They've actually clocked over 150 person hours since January just on litter picking.
150 hours. That's wild. Yeah. Can you imagine if like everyone listening just took even a fraction of that time to clean up their own neighborhoods?
Exactly. It just goes to show you that even small actions can make a huge difference when we all work together.
Couldn't agree more. Now, speaking of things that never seem to go away, this newsletter also talks about some landscaping issues.
Mm.
And get this, back in 84, there was actually a plan to dump trash on the common.
What?
Yeah, can you believe that?
I can only imagine the uproar that must cause.
Right.
It's interesting, though, because that's how Angela Rumbold, the MP at the time, got involved. She used the existing legal framework that protected the common to put a stop to it. She pointed out that altering its topography was actually against the law.
Wow, talk about using the system to protect itself. She was like the OG defender of Mitcham Common.
You could say that. And it reminds us that understanding those legal mechanisms is so important if we want to protect our green spaces.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Although it seems like those landscaping woes haven't gone away entirely. The newsletter talks about how some areas are so overgrown now that they're becoming like basically inaccessible.
Oh, really?
It's like those desire paths you see in parks where people just make their own trails because the actual paths are blocked.
Right, right.
It makes you think about that balance between letting nature do its thing and making sure people can actually, you know, enjoy the space.
It's a tough one for sure.
All right, let's shift gears for a second. From overgrown paths to, shall we say, unauthorized joyrides? Because it turns out motorcycles were a big problem even back in 84.
Oh, no, really?
Yeah, apparently some things never change.
The rumble of engines in nature?
The newsletter talks about damaged barriers, quad bikes tearing up the Seven Islands subside off-road bikes between Bitters and One Island. It's like they see a nice, quiet nature area and think, perfect place for some donuts.
It's interesting how some people view recreation and the need to preserve these delicate ecosystems. I mean, it's a public space. Finding a real solution, a real balance is so difficult.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How do you even begin to enforce that? Yeah, so you want people to be able to enjoy the space, but you also don't want them, you know, destroying it for everyone else.
It's a tough nut to crack, that's for sure.
It really is.
But speaking of tough nuts to crack, this newsletter also dives into the fascinating world of scrub clearance.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's not always glamorous, but somebody's got to do it.
This section was a trip. Did you see the part about the whole DIY scrub cutting incident back in 84?
Oh, yeah. The infamous tree felling spree. It's amazing how such a seemingly ordinary activity could cost such a kerfuffle.
Right.
I mean, someone even spray painted tree murderer next to save our trees on one of the fences.
It's like a war is being waged over these trees.
Yeah.
I mean, it really shows you how much people care about this place though, right?
Absolutely.
Even if they disagree about how to manage it.
That's a good point. And it highlights how something like scrub clearance, which seems pretty straightforward on the surface, can actually be quite complex.
Totally. And back then it sounds like a lot of the work was done by volunteers. With mixed results.
Yeah, they had their work cut out for them, that's for sure.
The newsletter mentions bonfires, lost contact lenses, even a punctured Wellington boot or two.
Oh, no.
It sounds kind of chaotic, but also kind of charming in a way.
There's a certain romance to the image of everyone just sort of pitching in, you know, getting their hands dirty.
Yeah, for sure.
But as our understanding of ecological management has evolved, so too have the methods. We've moved on from bonfires and Wellingtons to a more professional approach.
Now it's all spreadsheets and risk assessments.
Exactly.
Which I guess makes sense when you think about it.
It's not just about hacking away at bushes. It's about managing a delicate ecosystem.
Right. Speaking of complex systems, did you get to the part about land ownership? I always just assumed Mitcham Common was, you know, common land.
You'd think, wouldn't you?
Turns out it's not quite that simple.
It rarely is.
That whole thing about the bus stop on Commonside East and the land swap with Burton Council and the conservators, it's a whole saga.
Really?
It's like a real-life game of Monopoly with higher stakes.
Mm. I was wondering about the role of the conservators in all this. They seem to have a lot on their plate.
They do. They're the ones who are actually responsible for managing and protecting the common for everyone.
Right.
Which sometimes means dealing with these really complicated legal situations and making sure that everyone's interests are considered.
It makes you realize how much work goes on behind the scenes to keep these spaces running smoothly.
It does. And speaking of things that go on behind the scenes, can we talk about the Bitter Memorial for a second? They considered moving it.
Really?
Yeah, apparently. I mean, it's not every day you hear about someone wanting to dig up a memorial and move it to a different spot.
It does sound a bit odd when you put it like that.
So what was the reason?
Well, it seems like they were just trying to, you know, spruce things up a bit.
Spruce things up.
Yeah, give the memorial a little breathing room, maybe repaint the railings.
Right.
But then someone got the idea that maybe it wasn't in the optimal location.
So they called in the big guns, huh?
Pretty much. Structural engineers, consultations with English Heritage, a whole team of specialist stonemasons, all to figure out if they could even move the darn thing.
It's like they were building a rocket ship instead of just tidying up a memorial.
It's a bit much, isn't it?
A little bit. But hey, at least it shows they were taking their responsibility seriously.
That's one way to look at it.
So did they end up moving it?
You know what they say? If it ain't broke, don't fix it.
Words to live by.
The memorial stayed put.
Thank goodness for that. Can you imagine the uproar if they'd actually gone through with it?
I don't even want to think about it.
Right. So there you have it, folks. Litternoural. Landscaping, woes, rogue motorbikes, overzealous scrub, clearing the great bus stop land swap, and a memorial that just refused to budge. Just another 40 years on Mitcham Common.
Seems about right.
But really, though, it's kind of amazing when you think about it, how this one relatively small space has been at the heart of so many important issues over the years.
It's a reminder that these green spaces, these little pockets of nature in our towns and cities, they're constantly evolving. But the challenges and the triumphs, the dedication of people like the Friends of Mitcham Common, those things seem to transcend time.
Totally. And speaking of the Friends of Mitcham Common, their mission statement really resonated with me. It's in the newsletter here. To create and promote a wider interest and understanding of the wildlife and its habitat on the common.
That's a great mission statement.
It is, right? It's like, it reminds you that we all have a part to play in protecting these spaces.
We do. It's easy to forget sometimes in our busy lives, but these places need our support.
Absolutely. Well, I think that's about all the time we have for today. Thanks for joining us on this little deep dive into the history of Mitcham Common. It's been an adventure.
It has.
And hey, if you're ever looking for a way to get involved in your own community, maybe consider reaching out to your local Friends of the Park group. You never know. You might just find yourself swept up in the fascinating world of scrub clearance and memorial relocation.
Or maybe even a good old-fashioned litter pick.
Exactly. Until next time, everyone keep exploring.